Hello. Finally, in this lecture summary on Wundt, let me comment briefly on alternative approaches to psychology which emerged in the German-speaking world at this time, some of them in direct response to the Wundtian paradigm. The main figures to consider here are Franz Brentano, Hermann Ebbinghaus, George-Elias-Muller, and Oswald-Kulpe and the Wurzburg School. I should also mention other groups of thinkers who are covered in other lectures in this series, Sigmund Freud and the analytic movement, and the Gestaltists. First, Franz Brentano. Brentano was a Catholic priest who eventually left the church because he objected to the Pope's claim to infallibility. Born in the Rhineland, he had grown up in Bavaria and later taught philosophy at the University of Würzburg. After leaving the priesthood in 1873, he published his enormously influential Psychology from an Empirical Standpoint and took up a teaching post at the University of Vienna. Enormously popular with his students, he influenced many later famous men, including Karl Stumpf, who studied the psychology of hearing, Edmund Husserl, the originator of phenomenology, Christian von Ehrenfels, the originator of the concept of form quality or Gestalt, and Sigmund Freud, the founder of the psychoanalytic movement. An admirer of Aristotle, Locke, and John Stuart Mill, Brentano believed that psychology was the means of rescuing philosophy from the mystical morass that was Kantianism. At the same time, he thought that psychology must also be grounded in its philosophical roots. He saw empirical observation and rational argument as the main means of adding to human understanding of psychology, rather than experimentation as such. Although dismissed by Wundtian psychologists as a mere philosopher, Brentano had a lasting impact, both in the wider perspective of psychology which he imparted to his students, and in his key concept of intentionality, crudely, that which makes the mind more than simply a brain is the act of forming ideas about the world, judging them, and having feelings about them. Next, I should mention Hermann Ebbinghaus, the pioneer of memory research. With a background in philosophy, Ebbinghaus completed a doctoral dissertation on Eduard von Hartmann's concept of the unconscious in 1873 in his hometown of Bonn. He spent the next 7 years in independent study, becoming focused on the idea of adapting Fechner's techniques of exact measurement to higher-order mental functions, such as memory. During this time, he devised an exhaustive technique of memorizing lists of nonsense syllables, for example, bap, riff, tox, and carefully measuring how long it took to memorize each list, and under what circumstances he would remember the most syllables. To this end, he created a set of 2,300 syllables. He chose nonsense syllables in order to eliminate any subjectivity and the effects of his own previous experiences and associations, which might make some words easier to memorize than others. Completing thousands of trials and varying the conditions under which memorization took place, he explored the variables of memory. His findings included the following: that the difficulty of memorizing a list increases far faster than its length. For example, a list of 24 syllables is more than twice as difficult to learn than a list of 12 syllables. Again, repetition and review affect learning and forgetting, a finding of immediate relevance to any modern student who discovers the value of periodically reviewing what they are learning and going over material more than once. And again, that forgetting is related to the time lapses between learning and review and follows a definite forgetting curve. Ebbinghaus finally published his findings in 1885 as On Memory. By this time he had secured a job as an academic, teaching first at Berlin and later at Breslau and Halle. Ebbinghaus published relatively little, but what he did publish was extremely influential, notably two major introductions to psychology written in the early 1900s. Also of major importance was the Journal for the Psychology and Physiology of the Sense Organs, which he co-founded in 1890. This provided an alternative publication site for articles to Wundt's journal. Unlike Wundt, Ebbinghaus was tolerant of a diverse range of opinion, which was reflected in the journal's wide range of articles. He was also a popular lecturer, with a humorous and informal style quite different from that of a typical German professor of the time. And he initiated what proved to be a very effective test of the academic skills of local schoolchildren by devising completion tests for them to fill in, the ancestor of modern fill-in-the-blank tests. He died unexpectedly at the age of 60 after contracting pneumonia. Ebbinghaus's work was extended by George-Elias-Muller at the University of Göttingen. Muller was critical of the artificiality of Ebbinghaus's memory experiments, and instead asked subjects to think introspectively about the process of memorization while they were doing it. He found that their learning was not mechanical. Rather, they devised their own learning stratagems, consciously inventing meanings for meaningless syllables, and using grouping and rhythm to help them memorize better. These played a major role in memory. Learning was an active and creative process, not a passive one. Finally, let's discuss Oswald Kulpe and the Würzburg School. Kulpe was Wundt's former student and his assistant for 8 years. In 1894, he was appointed a professor at Würzburg, however, and was no longer under Wundt's shadow. Unlike Wundt, he believed that thought processes could also be studied in the laboratory, and after establishing his own laboratory in Würzburg, built it up so that it was soon second only to Wundt's lab in prestige. He and his students became known as the Würzburg School. Reflecting Kulpe's broader conception of the experimental method at Würzburg, students were asked to recall everything that went through their minds whilst performing a mental task so as to gain clues as to how memory worked. For example, the Würzburg researchers found that some thinking was imageless thought, for example, when adding up numbers or deciding if a statement was true or false. This contradicted Wundtian theory that all thought processes were composed of elemental sensations and perceptions. The Würzburg school expanded experimental psychology far beyond Wundt and led the movement towards a more holistic psychology. Thank you for listening. The next videos in the series are on William James, Wundt's American contemporary.